Good morning, church. Let's stand to our feet this morning. Let's just take a second to recognize the presence of the Spirit here with us. He wants to minister to your heart. He wants to give you fresh faith today. He wants us to trust him. He wants us to put our eyes on him. So let's start out the morning by doing that. Let's sing this together.
Be set.
courage. Mercy. It's compassion. He's faithful with his love to the generations. He's a God that from the beginning has not failed. He's a God that stayed true and steadfast, even when life and circumstances have come in and the enemy has tried, but God has remained faithful. I think of Joseph when he was sold into slavery, and then when he was accused, what does scripture say? But God was still with him. So we can sing that he is faithful, because even in the circumstances, even in the rain, the storms, for those who have put their hope and faith in Jesus, the rock, then we know that we can stand secure. Amen. So Lord, we thank you for that. We thank you, God, that you are our rock. We thank you that you're the same God of yesterday, and your same God tomorrow. And so then today we can say we know that you won't fail. Because we're yours, we have put our hope and our faith and our trust in you. And so because of that, we know that we can stand secure no matter what chaos, no matter what storm is around us. Our feet are planted securely on you, the rock, Jesus. And so with that, remind us to hope this morning. Would you speak to the people here in the room right now that are facing a storm that just does not seem to pass? Would you remind them that because they are yours, Jesus, you've got them, that you won't fail them. With them. Lord, would you just remind us the joy of our salvation this morning? Oh, we just need that reminder daily, moment by moment, the joy of our salvation in you, Jesus. Every time we sing this song, I just remember that you are my foundation, Jesus. That you won't fail. You won't fail me. You won't fail my brother and my sister. Faithful and true from beginning of time to end. We just thank you. Thank you. So you're worthy of our praises.
Yeah. Yes, Lord, we've gathered for that very purpose, that we could sing and say and mean it. Praise the Lord with 1,000 hallelujahs. We lift up your name today. Thank you, Lord, for leading us in worship. We pray all of this in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Why don't you go ahead and take a seat. Well, good morning, everybody. It's great to see you. Good job getting in through the rain. My name is Dave. I'm one of the care pastors here and want to just connect on a couple of things as we continue in worship. First of all, to guests who are here today, thanks for coming. We're so glad you're here. I got to meet two people today I've never met, first time at Harvest. Thanks for coming. We're not going to single you out. We don't want to embarrass you, but man, we'd love to say hello. So if we haven't met yet, I'm going to go out to the welcome table in the lobby and would hope to get to say hello before you leave today. We're glad you're here. For everybody, we're going to connect, and one of the ways we do that is our Connect card. So if you've done that or not done that, I invite you to use the Connect card. It lets us know you're here. It lets us know how we can be praying for you. So that's digital, so it's either the Harvest Bible Chapel app or the QR code that's on the seats around where you're sitting. Yeah, we just are really glad that we get to be a church family. We want to make sure we're connecting with one another. Hey men, we've got something for you. Some of you might have been handed a card walking in today about this conference that's coming up. It's called Men of God, and it's right here on our campus in October. It's a Friday night and Saturday, October 20, 21. If you want to use the QR code, it's right there. You can get the information. You can even register. Pastor Jeff Bucknam's going to be teaching at that. James Ford, who's another local pastor, will be teaching at that. And this is just a time for guys to connect with the Lord, connect with each other. Man, this world is not for us as followers of Jesus, men. But this is a chance to get with your brothers and put our eyes on the Lord. So I hope you'll prioritize that. Hey, we're going to encourage you as we think about giving today to be reminded of the truth that Jesus, we read of Jesus in Mark 12. He sat down opposite the treasury and watched the people putting money into the offering box. Many rich people put in large sums, and a poor widow came and put in 2 small copper coins, which make a penny. He called his disciples to him and said to them, "Truly I say to you, this poor widow has put in more than all those who are contributing to the offering box, for they all contributed out of their abundance, but she out of her poverty has put in everything she had, all she had to live on." I want to encourage you today that the Lord sees the heart, and he's most concerned with the heart. And the biggest gift might not be a big number, but it's a big sacrifice. And so we have the opportunity to give. That goes to extending the ministry of the church, that more people would know and love Jesus Christ. And so there's ways to do that that you see on the screen. There's a couple of boxes at the doors. But just know this, the Lord looks to our heart, and he is pleased when we put him first and worship him in this way. We're also going to pray for our church, but we're going to pray for another local church. Wheaton Bible Church is a fantastic church that's preaching Christ. I was in touch with a friend who's a pastor there this week, and I asked, "How can we pray for you?" And he said, "Pray that we would be faithful and accomplish God's mission for us in this generation, and pray that we would reach the communities around us with the gospel." Well, that's pretty cool, right? So we're going to pray for them in just a moment, that they would be faithful in that, and we're going to pray for our church as well. So let's all pray together. Lord, we do hope and pray that you are pleased with our offering of worship today. The attitude, the disposition of our heart, the songs, the giving, the receptivity to your word, all of it, Lord, we do because of you, and we do it for you. So, Lord, we want to pray right now for our friends at Wheaton Bible Church, that you would lead them by the power of your Holy Spirit. I pray that they would accomplish the mission you've entrusted to them. I pray that they would shine brightly for Jesus Christ in all the communities they get to touch. We pray that for a great work there, Lord. Be exalted through all of their efforts and encourage them and strengthen them. Lord, in our church, we want those same things. We want to be faithful to you. We want to reach people for Jesus Christ. And so give us your leading and your provision and your strength. Lord, thank you now. We get to hear from you directly from your word. So would you help us, Lord, to lean in, to receive what you have for us today. We pray all these things in Jesus' name. Everybody said, amen, amen. Well, in a moment, we're going to get into God's word, Acts chapter 12. But before that, I want you to just take a moment, and just stand up and find somebody and say, man, it's really glad you came to church today. Why don't you greet somebody? Church. It's good to see you. If you're new, my name's Tommy Creutz. I serve as the campus pastor of our Crystal Lake campus and on our teaching team, and it is good to worship in the house of the Lord today, isn't it? Come on. Well, I want to take a moment before we jump into our time in the Word and take a moment to celebrate. Harvest Bible Chapel launched on September 18th, 1988 with 18 people, and by God's grace and for His glory, we're celebrating 35 years of His faithfulness this weekend. Isn't that awesome? Praise the Lord. Which is wild to me because I'm also 35. I'm about a month older than our church, which is just crazy, right? But praise the Lord for His faithfulness. Amen. Well, you're going to need a Bible today. And we're going to be finishing up in Acts chapter 12. We're going to be going through verse 20 through 24. So kind of a short swath of scripture, but I think we've got a lot of truth in just four verses. And so open up there. This week, we get costumes for our kids. any other families do that? Anyone else? Yeah, like Ava, our daughter, has like 17 princess costumes. I'm just kidding, not that many, but a lot. It seems like that. And our son, Zion, will occasionally want a costume here and there. And wouldn't you know it, he wanted a ninja costume because he's been practicing karate. He's been fighting all of the invisible invaders in our house, right? As only an 8-year-old boy can do. And so he got the costume, and literally for the past like week and a half, he's just been running around karate fighting invisible people, right? He's just been going at it. And it's been amazing to watch. But he's also, in that fighting of the invisible enemy, he has gained confidence. And so it's been a while since me and my son had a little bit of horseplay, a little bit of wrestling, you know what I mean? And so he came up to me this week, he goes, Dad, I think I got some moves that can beat you. I'm like, oh yeah, son? He goes, I've been practicing all week, and I got some pretty sweet moves, and I think that they're stronger than you. I think I can defeat you. And I'm like, all right, man, well, let me see these moves. And so he does. He shows me his moves, his little punches, his karate kicks. It's very playful, nothing hard. And I'm like, dude, those are awesome. Those are great moves. Every single one of them, pretty great. And he goes, so Dad, you think you can beat me? I'm like, well, I'm your dad, you know? And he goes, okay, well, let's prove it. I want you to try against me right now. And I'm like, really? You want me to try? And he goes, yeah, give it your all. I didn't, but I did win, okay? And I won in the same way that I always win, which is that I grab him and then I fall to the floor and I hold him there until he gives up, right? And while we're there, and he is in my grip, unable to move, he fights with every ounce of 8-year-old muscle that he has, trying to get loose from my grasp, and he cannot, right? I don't even think it would matter if he was the strongest 8-year-old in the world. He wouldn't be able to get out of my grip. Why? Well, because I'm a dad, and we have dad strength, right? Dads, you know what I'm talking about? Sons, you know what I'm talking about? That supernatural strength that your dad has, like, it's just crazy. I became a dad one moment, and then I was like, it was like a superpower that happened. I got dad strength. And so no matter how hard Zion tries to get out of my grip, there's just no way that he possibly could. And I was thinking about that this week as I was preparing, because we're going to see a power dynamic kind of like that in the scriptures for us today, is a mismatch of power. One person whose power is so much greater than the others that it takes very little effort on the stronger person's part to win.
We're going to see it like that. And the title of our time tonight is called Get Agrippa. Get Agrippa. And if you don't get that just yet, you will in just a couple of seconds. Very rarely does a dad joke actually work as a sermon title, but here we are. So we're going to be in Acts chapter 12, verse 20 through 24. And we're going to see three important, simple truths that are found in this short passage for us. Here's the first one, is that God's name is higher. God's name is higher. Let's look at verse 20. It says, "Now Herod was angry with the people of Tyre and Sidon, and they came to him with one accord, and having persuaded Blastus, the king's chamberlain, they asked for peace." We're going to focus really quick on this person right here, Herod. This is not a person's name. This is a person's title. The person's name is Herod Agrippa. Now you might understand the title, Get Agrippa. Yes. But Herod is a title, and we actually see it throughout the Gospels and the book of Acts. It is a dynastic title of powerful rulers. Mostly from the same family, but some are appointed to the title of Herod, and there are quite a few of them. In fact, we see six of them in the New Testament. We see Herod the Great, if you remember him. Most people know Herod the Great because he was in the Christmas story, right? He was the one who ordered the young sons to be killed to try and eliminate the Messiah, right? He had also, though, three sons. Herod Archelaus, who shows up in the narrative where Joseph, if you remember, he chooses, instead of going to Bethlehem, he chooses to go to Nazareth. And the reason that he goes to Nazareth is because he is avoiding this Herod, because like his father, this Herod is pretty harsh in his rule. We also see Herod Antipas, who is the Herod who killed John the Baptist. We see his other brother, Herod Philip, and he shows up for just a brief moment in Luke chapter 3. It's just his name. He's not a very big part of the biblical narrative, but he ruled the area north and east of Galilee. And then we also see Herod Agrippa the First. That's who we're going to be looking at today. That's this Herod right here, Herod Agrippa the First. But he also had a son, Herod Agrippa the Second, who shows up in Acts 25 and 26, where he's interviewing Paul as he's imprisoned in Caesarea. And so this is a dynasty of rulers, and their name, Herod, was great in the area. Everyone knew the Herods. Everyone knew who they were and the authority that they had and the power that they had. Everyone knew their name. Their name was great. In fact, you can still see some of the sites that they built today, 2,000 years later. They're pretty big deals. Right? Pretty big deals. In fact, to maybe give us some modern examples of this, we have kind of dynasties of wealth, right? Of people who made it big and got a lot of money and have kept that money for a long period of time, like the Rockefellers or the Vanderbilts. Those might be names that you know. You're like, oh yeah, that's that really rich, powerful, wealthy family that's been around forever. It's a dynasty wealth. We also have political dynasties, right? The Kennedys, the Bushes, the Clintons, these are powerful political dynasties. We also have sports dynasties, like the Chicago Bulls, right? Oh man, you guys remember 91 to 98? Unbeatable, right? Or maybe the Yankees, right? From like the 30s to the 60s, Larry's really happy about that one. Or more recently, 96 to 2000, right? There's these dynasties, right? And these dynasties, these are dynasties that stayed wealthy, powerfully wealthy, or powerful politically, or they were dominant for a significant period of time. That's like the Herods in ancient times. Powerful rulers, economically powerful, politically powerful, dominant for a significant period of time. And Agrippa, in particular, was a pretty powerful guy. He actually had more territory than even his grandfather, Herod the Great, which was no small thing. He was a big deal. And not only was he a big deal, but he also liked hearing about it too. So Herod, angry with the people, they came to him with one accord, and having persuaded Blastus, the king's chamberlain, it's like his personal assistant, They asked for peace. So these coastal cities, Tyre and Sidon, they were clashing with Herod. And Herod, in his power, in his authority, he had the economic upper hand, if you will. And they relied on him for food, and he was oppressing them, not giving it to them. And so in their disputing, he was not giving them the food that they needed. And so they decided to come to him and ask for peace, because their country depended on the king's country for food. And then on an appointed day, Herod put on his royal robes, took his seat upon the throne, and delivered an oration, a speech to them. And the people were shouting, "The voice of a God and not of a man." And Herod did not refute that whatsoever. He liked it. And whether they were saying that genuinely or they were saying that out of flattery because they just wanted some food, it didn't really matter to Herod. He took it anyway. He didn't care, right? He was a powerful man from a powerful dynasty trying to make a powerful name for himself. But we're going to see very shortly that it pales in comparison to the name of the Most High God. Pales in comparison. You see, Herod was a king. It's a powerful name. He had much authority. He ruled over his subjects. He had power and wealth. He had a powerful name. He was a king. But Jesus Christ is the King of Kings, the Lord of Lords. And while Herod is a king, Jesus is the King of Kings. In fact, in Revelation 19:16, it says exactly that. On his robe and on his thigh, he has a name written: King of Kings and Lord of Lords. This is the name that is written on his robe and on his thigh. He is the King of Kings. He is the Lord of Lords. His name is greater than any earthly king. It is higher than any earthly king. He is the King of the Kings. In fact, there are multiple verses throughout the scriptures that point to God's rule as higher than armies and kings. In fact, let's take a look at a couple of them. In 2 Kings 19, it says, "Therefore, thus says the Lord concerning the king of Assyria, he shall not come into this city or shoot an arrow there or come before it with a shield or cast up a siege mound against it. By the way that he came, by the same way he shall return, and he shall not come into this city, declares the Lord. For I will defend this city to save it for my own sake and for the sake of my servant David." And that night, this is crazy, that night the angel of the Lord went out and struck down 185,000 in the camp of the Assyrians. That's a lot of damage, right? And do you notice? It's the angel of the Lord. The angel of the Lord. Our God's name is so high, or his authority is so much greater, that a single soldier in his army wipes out 185,000 of an earthly king. How amazing is that, right? That is the power of our God on display. The angel of the Lord did that. Isaiah 48:11, for my own sake, I do it. For how should my name be profaned? My glory I will not give to another. The glory goes to God's name and his name alone, because his name is higher. Blessed be the name of God forever and ever. To whom belong wisdom and might? This is Daniel. He changes times and seasons. He removes kings and sets up kings. Is it clear yet? He is the King of Kings. His name is higher. His name is greater. He has more authority than any king on this earth. He is sovereign, in control, reigning over everything and everyone. There is no king who is more powerful. There is no army that is larger or stronger. God's name is higher. And this is a great reminder to you and to me that our faith and our trust and our hope and our belief is in the greater name. That's where it is. And I don't think it's a surprise that Herod here in this chapter is a governing authority. He is a political leader. And we have been living in a politically charged world for a pretty decent amount of time, right? Still, it's happening. And we have people in our world who put their faith, their hope, their trust, their belief in the name of a politician, in the name of a governmental leader. They say, this is my guy, and I'm putting all my hope and my trust and my faith in him, and if he wins, he's gonna make everything all right. He's gonna fix all the problems in my life. He's gonna solve all the woes of society. He's gonna make everything just fine. And if he loses, the world is doomed. Everything's over, and I'm gonna talk about it for the next 4 years, right? Like, this is what we see happening over and over and over again in our politically charged world. The problem is that rhetoric is starting to infect the church, where we have now Christians who are placing their faith, hope, and trust in the name of a politician. And if he wins, it's gonna change our lives. It's gonna change our society. He is the answer to all of the problems. If we could just get him elected, everything's gonna be great. And if he doesn't, everything's gonna be awful. And what a reminder to you and to me to ask ourselves that question. Is our hope, is our faith, is our trust, belief more in the name of a politician than it is in the King of Kings, the name that is greater? Listen, I don't know about you, but I don't want to be like Tyre and Sidon. I don't want to give lip service worship to a man. I want to give my worship to the King of Kings, the highest name, Jesus Christ. Amen? Amen. So God's name is higher. Here's the second thing. God's justice is perfect. God's justice is perfect. The really interesting thing about Acts chapter 12 is that there's this really interesting bookend, right? It starts in verse 1. Acts 12 verse 1 says, about that time, Herod the king, again, this is Agrippa, laid violent hands on some who belonged to the church. He killed James, the brother of John, with the sword. You guys remember that from last week, right? Herod laid violent hands. He persecuted the church. And he even took one of the leaders of the church, right? James, son of thunder, and he killed him. And this is a bookend to what happens at this is the beginning of the chapter. Here's the end of the chapter. Immediately, an angel of the Lord struck him down because he did not give God the glory. And he was eaten by worms and breathed his last. Alternative title for the message, worm food, right? Immediately. So do you see the bookend there? Do you see what happened? Is in the beginning of the chapter, Herod laid his violent hands on the church, and at the end of the chapter, God laid his hands of violence on Herod. See the bookend? The mirror that's happening here, when you lay violent hands on the church, he lays them on you because vengeance is the Lord's and his justice is perfect. And he didn't just lay violent hands on the church though, Herod. In his pride, he wished to be divine, the voice of a God, not of a man. His pride welled up. He didn't reject or rebuke them. He took that. Wished to be divine. Tried to steal God's glory. So not only was he a persecutor of the church, but he was a glory thief. Listen, you don't mess with God's church and you don't mess with God's glory, right? As evident in Herod's life right here, because there is one God and he gets all of the glory. He does not share his glory as we saw in Isaiah. He doesn't share it. Jesus is the real king and all of the glory goes to him, and so the reward for glory thieves is worms. It's worms. In fact, this entire account of Herod Agrippa being struck down is actually historically confirmed by the first century Jewish historian, Josephus. He says this, now when Herod Agrippa had reigned 3 years over all Judea, he exhibited shoes in honor of Caesar, and he presented his flatterers his flatterers cried out that he was a god. And they added, be thou merciful to us, For although we have hitherto referenced thee only as a man, yet shall we henceforth own thee as superior to mortal nature. Upon this, the king did neither rebuke them nor reject their impious flattery, and a severe pain also arose in his belly and began in a most violent manner. His pain was become violent. Accordingly, he was carried into the palace, and when he had been quite worn out by the pain in his belly for 5 days, he departed this life. Do you see how that first century account directly lines up with the scripture, right? In fact, the scripture even goes to show us what the pain in his belly was. What was it? Worms. Right? The scripture even gives us the cause of his belly pains, which is worms. Listen, this is God's justice on display. His perfect justice on display. It's a reminder to us, to show us that he is a God of perfect justice, even when we don't see it. Because I think what happens for us is we have this question that always arises, especially as we live in the fallen world that we live in, right? Are the wicked really going to be punished? I see a lot of wickedness. Every day I open up the news, I see something more wicked, more and more wicked. It seems like the world is getting darker and darker and darker, and wickedness is continuing to happen, and corruption is continuing to happen, and it doesn't seem like there's any justice being met out for any of these people who are wicked. They keep getting away with it. Are the wicked going to go unpunished? Is God going to bring justice to the wicked? The answer is yes. He is, because his justice is perfect. And this is a reminder to us that the wicked will not go unpunished. He has the last say. He will punish the wicked, the guilty. He will bring his perfect justice. And even though you and I may not see it in our lifetime, sometimes we do. Sometimes we do see the perfect justice of God on display in our life. Sometimes we don't. But this is to remind us that even when we don't see it, his justice is perfect, and he will not let the wicked go unpunished. It's a display of his perfect justice. I think that there's also an application for us in this, because what we're looking at is a story of a prideful king, right? Prideful Herod, who is trying to steal the glory of God, who thinks that he can ravage the church. He's full of pride. And God humbles him, because God resists the proud and gives grace to the humble. And so I want to just share with us three stories of pride in the Bible, because I think that it's going to really help us apply this hopefully better to our life. The first story is the story of Naaman. In 2 Kings 5, Naaman is this powerful warrior, and he's a commander of the army of the king of Syria. And super important guy, but he has leprosy. And so he asks his king to reach out to the king of Israel to have one of the prophets come and heal him of his leprosy. And so in 2 Kings 5, verse 8, but when Elisha, the man of God, heard that the king of Israel had torn his clothes, he sent to the king saying, why have you torn your clothes? Let him come to me now, talking about Naaman, that he may know that there is a prophet in Israel. So Naaman came with his horses and chariots and stood at the door of Elisha's house. And Elisha sent a messenger to him saying, go and wash in the Jordan 7 times and your flesh shall be restored and you shall be clean. But Naaman was angry. Naaman got prideful in his anger because he wanted it to happen a certain way. He wanted Elisha to come out and to heal him. And he went away saying, behold, I thought that he would surely come out to me and stand and call upon the name of the Lord his God and wave his hand over the place and cure the leper. He had it all in his mind about how this was going to go and how he wanted it to go, and it wasn't going his way, and he got prideful. Are not Abana and Pharpar, the rivers of Damascus, better than all the waters of Israel, right? Pride. Could I not wash in them and be clean? Why did I come here to wash in the dirty Jordan? So he turned and went away in a rage, but his servants, thank God for his servants, came near and said to him, my father, it is a great word the prophet has spoken to you. Will you not do it? Has he actually said to you, wash and be clean? So Naaman, what does he do? Even though he was prideful, even though he was in a rage in his pride, He humbled himself. So he went down and he dipped himself 7 times in the Jordan, according to the word of the man of God, and his flesh was restored like the flesh of a little child, and he was clean. So this is a story of Naaman, who became prideful and angry. He's an important person, but then what did he do? He humbled himself. And when he humbled himself to the word of the Lord, he was cleaned and healed, right? All right, let's look at another story of pride. King Nebuchadnezzar, right? This is Daniel 4, verse 30. This is right after King Nebuchadnezzar hears Daniel's interpretation of his dream, where he tells King Nebuchadnezzar that God is going to humble him, okay? And this is what the king has to say. The king answered and said, is not this great Babylon, which I have built by my mighty power as a royal residence and for the glory of my majesty? And while the words, again, God resists the proud. While the words were still in the king's mouth, there fell a voice from heaven. O King Nebuchadnezzar, to you it is spoken. The kingdom has departed from you. And you shall be driven from among men, and your dwelling shall be with the beasts of the field, and you shall be made to eat grass like an ox. And 7 periods of time shall pass over you until you know that the Most High rules the kingdom of men and gives it to whom he will. Immediately the word was fulfilled against Nebuchadnezzar, and he was driven from among men and ate grass like an ox. And his body was wet with the dew of heaven till his hair grew as long as eagle's feathers, and his nails were like bird's claws. At the end of the days, I, Nebuchadnezzar, lifted my eyes to heaven, and my reason returned to me, and I blessed the Most High and praised and honored him who lives forever. At the same time, my reason returned to me, and for the glory of my kingdom, my majesty and splendor returned to me. My counselors and lords sought me out, and I was established in my kingdom, and still more greatness was added to me. Now I, Nebuchadnezzar, praise and extol and honor the King of heaven. For all his works are right, and his ways are just, and those who walk in pride, he is able to humble. Okay, so Naaman, story of someone who was prideful and humbled himself. King Nebuchadnezzar, story of someone who was prideful and God humbled them and then restored them, right? And then, of course, we have Herod as the last example, who was prideful upon prideful upon prideful, and God destroyed him. So 3 stories of pride: Naaman, Nebuchadnezzar, and Herod. Which one do you want to be? Which one of those do you want to be? Do you want to be the person who humbled himself and was cleaned and restored? Do you want to be the person who is prideful and then God humbles you? Or do you want to be Herod, who is destroyed? And you might think, like, I'm not like the King Agrippa, right? I'm not like King Herod. Like he's a king of over all of the, you know, all of these areas, and he has all of these subjects and all of this power and all of this wealth and all of this control. I'm not a king over a lot of people, but maybe you think you're king over your life. Maybe you think you're king over your life. I could do whatever I want. I could do what I please with my life. It's my life. I'm gonna do whatever I want. No one can tell me what to do. I'm the king of me. Listen to me, God resists the proud kings. Doesn't matter if your kingdom is large or just yourself. God resists you, but he gives grace to the humble. And in that humility, he restores and cleanses them. So which do you want to be? I don't know about you, but I want to be like Naaman, right? I want to humble myself, even when I get prideful, and I do. I want to humble myself and obey his word. So God's name is higher. God's justice is perfect. Here's the last one for us. God's power is greater. God's power is greater. We've seen it already, but immediately an angel of the Lord struck him down because he did not give God the glory, and he was eaten by worms and breathed his last. But the word of God increased and multiplied. It increased and multiplied. God's power is greater. God is more powerful than the powerful. He is more powerful than the powerful. And God's power is demonstrated through the killing of King Herod and through his word going forth, increasing and multiplying, right? It's demonstrated, God's power demonstrated through killing of the king first, right? And again, this is a mirror. This is a bookend in Acts 12. So remember in the beginning, Herod took, he laid his violent hands on the church and he took James and Peter, right? And he killed James. These were the leaders of the church. Herod was demonstrating his power as the king by showing that he can take the leaders of the church and kill them. That's how powerful I am. Don't you see it, church? Don't come against me. I'm powerful enough to grab your leaders and kill them. Bookend, God demonstrates his power by taking the king and killing him. King who thinks he's so powerful, God demonstrates his power and takes him out. Right, there was a comparison last week that Jeff showed in the scripture of the hand of the Lord versus the hand of Herod. But we also have a comparison in this scripture, because not only did God show his power by killing the king, the most powerful person, he demonstrated his power in increasing and multiplying his word. And the comparison that we have here is the voice of a God, Herod, to the word of God. The voice of a God versus the word of God. And God shows his power. Says, whose voice is greater? Is it the voice of this God, Herod, or is it the word of God? Well, Herod died. And his voice ceased. When one of the leaders of the church died, God's word multiplied and increased. This is actually a phenomenon that happens throughout the early church. God's word multiplying in the face of persecution and martyrdom. Tertullian, the Christian defender of the faith, said, we multiply whenever we are mowed down by you. The blood of Christians is the seed of the church. And Jerome said about 100 years later, the church of Christ has been founded by shedding its own blood, not that of others, by enduring outrage, not by inflicting it. Persecutions have made it grow. Martyrdoms have crowned it. The word of God goes forth, even in the face of persecution. It is multiplied and increased. And so if you were to kind of give a summary of questions on chapter 12 in Acts, I think those questions would be these two questions. Whose power really matters? And whose voice really matters? If we were to take a summary, whose power really matters and whose voice really matters? Is it that of an earthly king or is it that of the Most High God? The answer, God, right? God's power really matters and God's voice really matters. And this is a reminder that God is powerful and in control. His power is greater. He is more powerful than even the most powerful in positions of power. And sometimes we as Christians, we can become a little doom and gloom. Have you seen that? Maybe you've experienced that. Again, we see all of this wickedness and this corruption taking place, and we can kind of get really upset about it. We can become doom and gloom. I don't see God working. Why isn't he moving in this? Why is he allowing this to happen? When is his justice coming? Is it ever coming? I don't see him working. I don't see him moving. All I see is more and more and more wickedness. And the Christian becomes doom and gloom, because what we have is we have a snapshot of the here and the now. We have a snapshot of right now. And yeah, the picture maybe looks bleak right now. But God has the whole picture. He's got the fullness of the picture. Can you imagine if the church took a snapshot of chapter 12, verse 1 and 2? Herod laying his violent hands on the church and killing James and imprisoning Peter. Snapshot. It's over. It's all over, guys. Our leaders are killed. The Lord didn't save them. He's not saved. It's over. We might as well just hang up the towel. It's over. They could become real doom and gloom, right? That's just a snapshot of the fuller picture, the full picture. that God's name is higher, that his justice is perfect, and that his power is greater. And he shows that through the destruction of Herod and his word multiplying and increasing. Is anyone here Lord of the Rings fans? Lord of the Rings? Right? I'm looking at one right now, and I know they love the Lord of the Rings. Remember the Battle of Helm's Deep? You guys know that battle? It got to a pretty dire place, right? The wall had been blown up. All of the armies rushing forward. They're trapped in the keep. Everything looks like it's over. And they're like, all right, I guess, you know, desperation move. Let's make one last charge and go out in a blaze of glory, right? Snapshot that moment. Pretty dire, right? You get pretty doom and gloom about it, right? But there's a fuller picture that is happening, and that is that Gandalf comes over the horizon with the army and crashes down into the army, winning the battle, right? That's the difference between the snapshot of the moment and the fullness of the picture. You and I don't have the full picture of how it's going to end. And we might not see it in our lifetime, but God sees all of it. He's got the full picture. And listen, nobody can stop God. God is undefeated. His power is greater. His name is higher. His justice is perfect. He is sovereign. He is in control. He has the full picture. And so we as Christians, we don't need to be doom and gloom. We must wait on the Lord, who is faithful. Amen? And we remember that through persecution, through wickedness, the word of God increases and multiplies. The grass withers, the flowers fade, the worms eat, but the word of God remains forever. Amen? Let's pray. God, we thank you for our time in your word today, and Lord, we're thankful for the truths that you have for us. Sometimes, Lord, it can be really discouraging to live in this fallen world where we see wickedness and corruption and prideful rulers over us. Lord, I pray that you would give us hope for the future, that you would help us to wait on you and your perfect justice. We don't have to get that justice or vengeance. The vengeance is yours. Your perfect justice is coming. We can trust and believe that. Lord, I pray that you help us to continue to look to you, to put our hope and our trust and our faith, that we don't place it on the rulers of this world, but we place it on the King of Kings. Lord, I pray that any pride that we have in us, that you would destroy, Lord. Would we be a people who humble ourselves and obey your word? And if we don't, Lord, would you humble us? Lord, we don't want to be Herod. Your name is higher. Your justice is perfect, Lord. And your power is greater. Help us to hold on to those truths as we go about our week. Help us to live in that reality instead of the one that we see with our eyes before us and the snapshot that we have. Let us trust and know that you have the full picture in mind, and that you are a God who is undefeated. We love you, Lord. Thank you for this time. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen. Let's go ahead and stand to our feet. Sing one more song together this morning. You were the Word at the beginning, one with God. Now revealed in you are Christ.
There's just certain things you don't regret. Like getting up on a Sunday morning, getting over to church, getting our eyes back on Jesus, being reminded that his name is greater, his power is higher, and the word of God stands forever. And we will never regret moments or decisions of humility, of surrender to the Savior Jesus. And so it's just good to worship together this morning. If we can pray for you this morning, I hope you'll come forward and let us know. We've got leaders here to pray for you. It's still raining, so there's really no rush. Just enjoy talking to some people. We're having a welcome party today. If you're like, I don't really know people here, I'd like to meet somebody, I'd like to learn more about the church, you can do it right now. So right across the lobby in the Hope Center, come on over. We'd love to say hi and see you at the welcome party. Now we're going to leave this room. We're going to go out on mission for Jesus Christ. As you do that, know you are loved.